The day before Good Friday is often known as Maundy Thursday, and this is the day where we reflect upon Jesus' time spent with his disciples, especially when he's instituting the Lord's Supper in the upper room. It also takes us to the story of Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. And here in the Gospel of Luke, it starts in Luke chapter 22, starting in verse 7. Here's a little bit of, Bible trivia and some little bit of Christian history for you. The early Jews, and really still Jews today, typically celebrate the start of a new day at sunset. Here in the West, we start our days at sunrise, so it's a little bit confusing when we're looking at the days leading up to the events of Jesus' death and resurrection. But here is a little bit of context. As years ago, I was able to go to Israel, and I gotta tell you, their Sabbath starts on Friday night with a huge bang. As soon as the sun goes down, they are there at the Western Wall, ready to worship. It's something that completely throws us off, as typically in our Western culture, when days start is usually with the sun rising. But in a Jewish context, it always began as the sun set. So on Wednesday night, as the sun is setting, after teaching in the temple all day long, Jesus is leaving the city, leaving the temple, and going to stay with his friends, Lazarus, Mary, and Martha, in Bethany. As he's on his way out, he turns to a few of his disciples and he tells them to go back into the city and to find an upper room so where they can start to spend their feast of unleavened bread time together. Jesus prepares his disciples and tells them specifically how they're going to find the room and how all of the details are going to be worked out. So that happens at sunset on Wednesday night. Jesus then in the morning goes back into the city, back into the temple, and teaches all day long. And we don't have any records of what is actually taking place on that day here in the Gospel of Luke, but we can assume that he is teaching a lot of the same things he's been teaching all week long. He's teaching the truths of the gospel as well as challenging the religious leaders of his day, knowing that he is about to face his trial and execution. So it is that night after sunset, and again, we're celebrating Maundy Thursday, but technically on a Jewish calendar, this is the beginning of Friday, the beginning of the 24-hour period that Jesus has where he will both suffer in the garden as he's teaching his disciples, where he will be betrayed, where he will go on to be tried and wrongfully convicted and face the cross, all dying within this 24-hour period. But here Jesus meets with his disciples. He sits down with them and he shares with them the Feast of Unleavened Bread. This was a tradition that came out of their Exodus coming out of Egypt and the fact that they didn't have time to prepare. They didn't have any leaven. They left the city in a rush. And this was a reminder of how God had rescued them in this unique way. Jesus sits down with his disciples and then explains to them that this was really a picture, a foreshadowing of what Jesus is going to do in rescuing his people, not from slavery to Egypt, but from slavery to sin. As Jesus is teaching this to his disciples, he turns to them and says that one of them is going to betray him. Obviously, we know the story. We know this is Judas, as yesterday Judas had already been conspiring with with the Pharisees. But as we're looking at this story, Jesus tells his disciples and they get furious, trying to figure out which one of them is going to commit this atrocity. But in the same process of talking about who none of them would actually betray Jesus, turns quickly into a conversation of which of them is the greatest. Isn't that interesting how so often we start off with a negative, but we turn it into a positive that really actually turns out to be a negative? As the disciples are debating about who is the greatest, Jesus reminds them of the true cost of discipleship, the true cost of following Jesus. As Jesus takes them to the Garden of Gethsemane, he asks them to stay up and pray with him, but they can't. They don't understand the severity of the moment, and they just disregard Jesus' request, and they take a nap. So when Jesus is officially betrayed, it's Peter who lashes out. But after that, all of his disciples run, and they scatter. They were not prepared for what Jesus had been teaching them and what he had been preparing them for in understanding the significance of this day. Here, Jesus is talking to them about one who will betray them. But the reality is, they all turned their backs on him. They all left him. They all ran in seeking their own shelter and their own safety. And they betrayed Jesus in one of the harshest ways. And this is a reality for each and every one of us. We often don't think that we're in need of being reprimanded. It's the others who have the problem. And we're very quick to point fingers at those who we might think, well, they're not of the great disposition to be able to stand as I'm able to stand. It was Peter, in fact, who claimed that there is no way he could betray Jesus. But it was Peter who denied him 3 times. We need to remember, as the disciples needed to learn, that we are all broken. In the span of these few hours, the disciples go from excitement of being with Jesus and excitement of thinking how great they truly are to understanding that they were just as broken as everyone else.